So, hello everyone. My name is Stéphane Bourreau. I'm from the laboratory Exascale Computing Research in France. It is a laboratory in collaboration with the CEA, the Commissariat d'Énergie Atomique, Intel, and Versailles University. Today, I'm going to present the article Implementation and Performance Evaluation of MPI Persistent Collective in MPC, a case study, which is about Persistent Collective, which has been recently accepted in the new MPI 4 standard. So we wrote this article to share to the HPC community, and more precisely the MPI-1, the way we integrate and optimize them in a runtime MPC. So the content of this presentation is the following. First, I will do an introduction presenting the non-blocking and persistent collective interface to better understand persistent mechanisms and utilities. Also, I will present our contribution in this article. I will present the naive implementation we did of a naive persistent collective in a runtime NPC, and then I will present the optimization we did on top of it. Then I will present you how we evaluate and benchmark our different optimization and our naive implementation, and I will conclude. So first, let's compare the non-blocking interface with the persistent collective one. So there is two procedure calls with the non-blocking interface, which lets not much room to finely distribute the computing cost of the entire collective process. So the starting and the initialized part is called with the procedure MPI I followed by the name of the collective, with the arguments of the collective and the MPI request to retrieve the operation among others. So it may return before the operation starts, and the operation can be done at any time by the runtime. The completion will be done with the call to the procedure MPI wait and its derivative. It will return when the collective is completed, and it will have to free the resources and the okay. So for concerning the persistent collective interface, there is a four procedure call, which will allow a finer distribution of the computing cost of the entire collective process. So the initialization is done with the call to the procedure MPI, followed by the name of the collective, followed by init, given an argument, the argument of the collective and MPI requests. It will initialize the collective and return before the operation starts. And so it set the requests, the persistent request, to inactive, which means that it can be freed or started because the operation hasn't started, and the arguments and the type of the collective will be registered for the subsequent call to the procedure MPI start and its derivative, which will trigger the operation associated with the type of the collective. It will set the request to active, which means that the request can be freed or started because it has just been triggered. The completion will be done with the call to MPI wait and its derivative. It will set the request to inactive, which means that it can be freely started because the operation just end. And a last procedure call for this persistent interface is the MPI request free, where the request will be validated and where the user is sure to not reuse it. It is also a place where the resources of the collective can be free. So here is an example of a code with the non-blocking and persistent collective interface. It is a context where a persistent collective could be useful over a non-blocking one. So it is a context of repetitive invocation, so here a for loop. As you can see, the persistent collective can be initialized outside the repetitive context invocation, so outside the loop, whereas the non-blocking call have to do the initialization in the first procedure call of the interface. So whereas the persistent collective just can call the procedure MPI start just to trigger the operation and remove the cost of initializing the operation at each invocation of the operation. Also, concerning the completion, both interfaces will call the procedure MPI wait, but the non-blocking collective will have to free the resources of the collective, whereas the persistent one do not have to do it. It can be done outside the loop with the call to the procedure MPI request free. So, to summarize, the advantage of persistent collective in the context of repetitive invocating in the context of repetitive invocation is that we can remove setup and remove ring overhead, and so we can explore further algorithm where the initialization is costly, but where the benefits of the algorithm will hide this cost because the cost of the initialization will be paid once. So her contribution is the paper is to propose a naive persistent implementation of the persistent collective in a runtime MPC, which is based on the non-blocking one. It is an implementation that can be done by every runtime implementing non-blocking collective. Also, we propose two optimizations based on caching mechanisms. The first one, we aim to cache the internal schedule of the collective, which is the communication scheme for each MPI process, which is similar to what has been proposed in libPNBC. Also, we propose another optimization on the caching of the intermediate send and receive of the schedule of the collective. And we propose also the evaluation of our naive and those optimization in our MPC runtime. So now let's talk about the persistence implementation, the naive one. So to do so, I will introduce libNBC that we integrate and modify in our MPC runtime to implement non-blocking collective. I will do this because the persistent collective that we implement are based on the non-blocking one. So here is an example of the mechanisms of libNBC on with a binomial reduce. So there is four ranks in this example. Rank zero is the root. And in the reduce operation, all the data have to do an operation with their own data, and the result has to be sent on the root process. So below, you can see next to each rank the schedule of operation, and it is composed of rund. Rund is a set of operations that can be done asynchronously by each MPI processes. And there is internal wait all operation on the intermediate send and receive created during the parsing of the scheduling that is called because we do not want to start the next one while those intermediate send and receive are not all. So as we can see, rank one and rank three only have one rune. This is because in the binomial reduce, the odd rank only send their data and their contribution is over. And when all the runes of every processes are over, this is the end of the operation, the entire collective is completed. So we did some modification to integrate and optimize the use of libNBC in our runtime. I will present some of those. So in libNBC, the schedule was built using realloc operation at each newly operation encountered during the parsing of the scheduling. In MPC, we compute the size statically to allocate the memory once. We transform MPI calls in MPC internal calls. Also, libNBC was duplicating communicator to ensure to not interfere with the user communication. We used internal structure and message tag in MPC. The progress thread was pthread, and in MPC, we use user-level MPC internal thread to be recognized by our scheduler and do specific placement. So now I will present the naive implementation, which is based on the non-blocking collective that we did in our runtime. So the idea is simple, is to fulfill the minimum requirement from the MPI standard. So the operation, sorry, first in blue, this is the user interface operation of the persistent interface. And in green is the operation of our MPC runtime. So the MPI followed by the name of the collective followed by init, so the initialization will register the operation with the MPI request. It will store the type of collective and also the argument of the collective. The call to MPI starts will retrieve with the MPI request the type of the collective and the arguments, and we call the associated non-blocking collective. A new request will be created for the non-blocking call, which will be embedded in the persistent request. So all the non-blocking call is done is will be done at this step. The first one will be start, and the communication is triggered. The completion will be done with the call to MPI wait, and it will call the internal progression in the non-blocking of the non-blocking of our MPC runtime. And when the last round of the collective is over, all the internal structure will be freed as for the non-blocking collective. At the end, at the last procedure call, so the MPI request free, the request will be unregistered and the user is sure to not call the operation again. So what about this naive implementation? First of all, it is based on the non-blocking collective. It is in accordance with the MPI 4 standard, but there is no benefit done via the persistent mechanisms. This is why we call it naive. So we do not avoid the cost of the initialization at its start and at its starting, and we do not avoid the costs of the freeing part at each completion. So now I will present the optimization we did on top of this naive implementation. So the first optimization is obvious. It consists of not recreating some internal structures at each start of the operation and release them at each completion. So it is mainly about the scheduling of the algorithm. It will be created at the first call to the procedure MPI followed by the name of the collective followed by init, so the initialization, where so not all the non-blocking call will be invoked, but just the initialization part, so with the creation of the scheduling. And then at the start call, this scheduling will be retrieved with the type of argument and the argument of the collective, and the first one will be invoked. And so at the completion, at the last one, when the collective is over, this internal structure and mainly the scheduling are no more freed, and it will be retrieved at each start of the collective, and which avoid the cost of creating them and releasing them at each persistent operation at each collective. And so this internal structure will be freed at the last procedure call, which is the MPI request free call. Concerning the second optimization, we wanted to save the cost of building new requests each time while parsing the scheduling. So I'm talking about the non-blocking send and receive created during the parsing of the scheduling. So we transform them in sort of persistent send and receive because they will live as long as the persistent collective itself. So to do so, at the first call of the MPI start procedure, those requested will be created as usual, and at the end of each round they will no more be released. They will be kept, and subsequent call to the MPI start procedure will know that those requests have been created, and they will just retrieve them to be reused. So at the completion of the first invocation of the collective, the request will be tagged to indicate that those requests have already been created and that subsequent call can retrieve them. And they will be freed at the last procedure call of the persistent interface, which is the MPI request free call. So some insight about this last optimization. We can ask why we create those intermediate requests at the first starts of the collective and not at the initialization step. It is because we want to avoid the case where the persistent isn't used but initialized, because we don't want to waste request structure resources. Also, this optimization has been possible thanks to the change we made in libMVC, in our integration in libMVC in MPC, which is mainly about the static scheduling allocation and the arithmetic pointer we did to parse it. So now we will see how we evaluate and benchmark our different implementation and optimization. So we didn't have access to any persistent with an application with persistent collective call because it's a new features and we didn't change any non-blocking call in any application. We use micro benchmarks to evaluate the performances. So here is a for loop with 500 iteration where the sorry see 500 iteration where the non-blocking and persistent interface are invoked to compare. So we choose 500 iteration because it is a number high enough to for the fastest configuration to be measurable. Each MPI process will measure the time to do the overall loop and a reduce operation will be done at the end to keep the slower MPI process as result. We use Intel Sandy Bridge node because they are the one on which we have the most access. There are 2 8 core sockets with 16 cores per node. We did two benchmark variations. The first one, which is a number of MPI processes variations, where we communicate one integer in the argument of the collective. We did this until 8 nodes, which represent 128 ranks. Also, we did a variation of the size of the buffer of the collective on one full node with one MPI process per core. So I choose here to display some collective order or in the article. Also, the naive implementation displays the same results as the non-blocking ones. It is because the naive implementation just called the non-blocking collective, so it is logical that we have the same performances. You can see all these results in the article if you want. So on the egress axis is the execution time in log to scale, on the x-axis in the number of MPI process. We compare the naive implementation with one optimization and both optimization. We can see that in all cases, one optimization provides better results than the naive implementation, and both optimization provides better results than one. We also can see that the higher the number of rank is, the less the improvements are noticeable. This is because the application is more and more driven by the communication part. So yes, also we can see that at the internode transition, there is this is the optimization is even less noticeable with the internode transition because the communication part is even more important. So our caching optimization is less noticeable. So concerning the broadcast and the reduce, they are based on binomial tree algorithm, which on which there are several rounds, and there is a lot of parallel communication. So this algorithm impact more the creation and the initialization and freeing of the internal structure. This is why our optimization, we aim to reduce those last calls by caching them. This is why those collective had good results. So we obtain until tree speed up on the reduced collective. So on one full node with 16 MPI rank. Also, we have the same profile so with the broadcast, but it is a bit less impacted. contrary, the scatter is less impact. This is not the same tree shape. It is a flat tree where the root will send to every other ranks. There is so the weight of the communication is more important, and this is why our optimization is less noticeable on this collective algorithm. Sorry. So here I display some all-to-all collective type. So there is the all reduce, which is a reduce plus a broadcast algorithm. So for the reasons I just discussed, we have good results because reduce and broadcast did well with our optimization. Concerning the whole tool, there was also a lot of parallel communication, but there is a critical number of communication which will increase with the number of MPI of rank, and this is why it is less impacted by our caching optimization. Here I display the result on the buffer size variation. So we did it on the intranode because, as we just see, the internet communication reduced the impact of our optimization. So on the x-axis, now you can see the size of the buffer of the collective arguments in bytes. We can see that the combination of both optimizations bring the best performances, and we obtain a speed up until the very large size of 2 power 16 bytes. Also, the impact of our optimization decreases with the size of the buffer. This is because the communication time becomes more and more important. The all-to-all seems to have a different behavior above 32 bytes. This is because the speed up this is because the speed up reduction is due to the critical number of operations, we suppose, and it dropped from 2 to 1.5, even with this reduction. So now I will conclude. So Persistent Collective are now available in the MPI 4 standard. Here we share an implementation of our native implementation of these features in our MPC runtime, which is based on non-blocking collective and which can be done by any runtime implementing non-blocking collective. In the second time, we propose two optimizations based on caching mechanism. The first one, which is similar to what has been done in libpmbc, is to cache the internal scheduling of the collective. And the second one, which aims to cache deeper internal structure and transform the intermediate send and receive in sort of persistent one. Also, we only focus on software and not the underlying hardware. And persistent can be of interest with the use of network capabilities with remote direct memory access, for example. With a right level of abstraction, network relative construct can also be prepared and cached in the persistent initialization phase and to reduce even more the cost of the operation. So you can see in the conference of this year the poster toward an optimal all-reduce communication in message passing system concerning the network capabilities. And thank you for your persistent attention. If you have any questions, you're welcome.
Thank you, Stefan. Questions, please. Let's see. Is there any question on Slack? Not yet. Let me then ask a question. So can you go back to slide number 25? Mm-hmm. The slide where you present the benchmarking code? Yes. So Here it seems that for each iteration, you are using the non-blocking and persistent collectives like blocking collectives, right? Have you considered starting them, you know, and then finishing them after the for loop, right? So that they run concurrently? And have you also considered maybe, I don't know, interleaving them with actual computations? Because in that case, these interleavings, I don't know, may have some impact on, you know, scheduling and so on. Maybe you need to do things dynamically. Maybe the static scheduling is not optimal. So did you look at these aspects? Did you consider them at all?
In our benchmark, we only this evaluation. So yeah, it could be of interest to figure out if there is an impact while introducing computing costs between the invocation, but we did not do it. We only evaluate the performances of the optimization and the implementation with this benchmark. But it can be of interest, yes, to see if there is any interference with introduction of code in between, yes.
And what is your feeling? Would you think that the static scheduling would still be optimal in that case?
Like this, I would say yes, because as the concerning the persistent collective, as it will be done outside the repetitive invocation context, so it's good that it is done statically because it will be done once. So we do not want to do it to be done dynamically. I suppose, yes.
Well, it may be the case that the computation behaves differently at each iteration, so then the interference may behave differently. These are all interesting questions, I think. Very nice. Thank you. So can you also comment a little bit on MPC? I was not actually familiar with this implementation of MPI. What is its relationship with the other MPI implementations? Have you compared your implementation with, you know, the implementations available in other MPI implementations?
We do not know if there is other MPI implementation with persistent collective. So no, we did not compare. So no, we did not do it. We only used MPC in runtime to do our own evaluation and to better understand the interests of these features.
And what would you consider a strength of MPC in general, maybe not just specific to your work in this paper compared with the other MPI implementations?
I would say, for example, in this work, this is a thread-based runtime. So we have good results on one full node with one MPI process per core with the reduce, for example, which is executed with one operating system process. While every MPI ranks are user level thread, and so we can use the shared memory. We can use the shared memory with this thread based easily, more efficiently, maybe, I would say. So yes, it is a runtime which aims to be executed with one OS process per node and use user level thread to spawn MPI processes inside this OS process. This is the strength of MPC.
Thank you, Stefan.